Hi, my name is Leon Rowe, currency trader and trading coach at trading180.com, and welcome to this week's Forex and Gold Fundamental and Technical Analysis. If you like the weekly videos that I provide, don't forget to like, subscribe and share with your fellow trading colleagues. And so, getting into the week ahead for May the 15th and zooming in a bit, in the US, the spotlight will be on speeches by several Fed officials and retail trade data, followed by industrial production and several housing indicators, including housing starts, building permits, and existing home sales. Elsewhere, second quarter GDP growth rates will be released in Japan. That will be important because it's their first second quarter GDP reading. And moving on, investors will also be closely following industrial production and retail sales for China. Again, China is important for global growth, so that would definitely be important as well as inflation rates for Canada and Japan. And again, inflation is really should be watched, because it really kind of at the moment is dictating to central banks whether they should be holding or hiking at the moment, or even potentially looking to cut in the future. Towards the end of the year, and unemployment rates for the United Kingdom, France and Australia. Additionally, the ZEW indicator for economic sentiment for Germany and the GFK consumer confidence indicator in the United Kingdom will be interesting to watch. And so that's what's coming up this week. And before we get into the usual technicals, I did a video breaking down the fundamentals surrounding the euro dollar, the first quarter fundamental review, and that will be at the end of this video. So I go back, look at the first 3 months, January, February, March, and look at the fundamentals and how it affected price. So you can really kind of get an idea and an understanding of a fundamental understanding, a basic understanding of how fundamentals do affect price over the medium to long term. And so don't forget to watch that at the end of the video. So let's get into the charts. And looking at the dollar index, which is just a measure of strength of the dollar against the basket of currencies. And fundamentally, we've got risk events on the horizon. So stock traders, stay calm about US being on cusp of default. So credit default swaps are spiking as the VIX stays unchanged, and route could create buying opportunity if debt deal is struck, says Citi. So the debt ceiling standoff in Congress has the US at risk of being unable to pay its bills as soon as June the 1st. You'd think stock market investors would be anxious about the uncertainty, but you'd be wrong. While hedging activity is picking up on the fringes, there are a few signs of panic expectation for price swings in stocks most sensitive to a government default, still hovering near a two-year low. And so that's interesting. But make no mistake, the risk is real. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen said Friday that the US will have to default on some obligation if Congress doesn't raise the debt limit. It's just equity investors don't seem to care, or maybe they're just expecting that the deal's going to get done anyway, right? And so the uncertainty around the debt ceiling is like kicking a man when he's already down, said Adam Phillips, the managing director of portfolio strategy at EP Wealth Advisors. Depending on what happens with the debt ceiling, we could see additional fiscal drag in addition to monetary policy that would eventually need to be reflected in stock valuations, because it's not showing up yet, so it hasn't been priced in yet. And in the bond market, investors are on high alert. The cost of credit default swaps insuring treasuries against a default is higher than contracts on bonds of countries like Greece and Brazil, but things are more complacent in the stock market. So it doesn't look like the stock market is too concerned. The bond market is. And it talks here as well that the US economy is potentially approaching a recession after the Federal Reserve's most aggressive monetary policy tightening campaign in a generation, and a crisis in the banking system is still simmering. So there are definitely lots of risks on the horizon for the US dollar. And the Fed's Jefferson says inflation high, but policy on track. And so, we've got also monetary policy opinions from Fed Governor Philip Jefferson said in the progress on inflation this year has been mixed, but noted that policy takes time to percolate through the economy and is well on track. And the US Central Bank earlier this month indicated that it may be ready to pause its rate hiking campaign, which last year included four consecutive 75 basis point increases before a slowdown in the last 6 months as it assesses how the policy works its way through the economy. But policymakers haven't committed yet to an end of date of the hiking cycle, saying instead they are pivoting to a meeting by meeting approach to decision making and weighing all available data as inflation has cooled more slowly than they have expected. So there are, I think all central banks are going through the same thing, but particularly in the US, inflation has remained sticky. And so although the expectation is for the Federal Reserve to actually hold rates, so if you go to the CME FedWatch tool, you'll see that in fact there's an 84% chance of a no change and a 15% chance of a hike. At the moment, it's being priced in to the market, and this can change based off of whether inflation stays high or remains, you know, obviously where it is, or starts to continue to come down. But the expectation is that inflation will come down, which would then mean that the Fed are less likely to hike, which then would put a cap really on the dollar upside and all the risk events that are happening potentially, saying that they will, but with the US potentially going into a recession, banking risks, risks that the America won't pay their debts or won't agree to raise the debt ceiling are all also weighing on the dollar potentially. So let's see what happens there. My bias is still to short the dollar, and it's come up to a decent level. So for me, I think this could be a decent area to look for confluences to short. You wouldn't short the dollar index, but you would short, you know, if it's coming up into a supply zone on the dollar index, then you would look for potential supply zones on the dollar yen to get involved in. So there's the dollar index, and again the levels in between that we're looking at. Technically, I think it's come up to a decent area, the 102.50s and even the 103.50s. I think are decent areas to look for potential reversals. So I think the 103s would be definitely a nice, better place to look to short the dollar. Dollar yen. So the dollar yen. Again, the Fed expected to hold rates. And the Bank of Japan are holding rates, but possible yield curve control adjustment in June or July around that time. Yield curve control adjustment would actually appreciate the currency. And so my bias overall is to actually get short on this currency pair. So I'm really looking for a decent pullback. This level's been touched several times, in fact, this supply zone. So it's not necessarily the freshest area of supply. And so for me, I think the level just above it, if we can get to the 138s, 139s, I think that would be really nice for a short trade. And so, yeah, that's where my bias is. In the short term, though, you could see, obviously, the dollar start to, you know, to rally, especially if there's good news that comes out for the dollar. I think the dollar could actually, you know, move higher against most currencies, but that just creates for me an opportunity to get, you know, short at better prices. And so yeah, if you are looking for short trades, just be careful that if you are shorting or attempting to short at this area, the 137s, this level has been touched several times, and so the more times the level is touched, it's the weaker it becomes. But if you do want to be a buyer of the dollar against the yen, then you know, you should have really got involved in here. Any pullbacks into the 133s, I think, are decent buying opportunities, potentially. Get rid of that. And yeah, I think that's pretty much where we are. Dollar Swiss, same scenario where if I was looking to get involved in this pair, it would be to the short side based off a more risk sentiment. The Swiss National Bank are actually hiking, expected to hike one more time, and they are slightly a bit more hawkish, and the Federal Reserve are. And so there are opportunities, I think, for a decent pullback to the 90.50 area, 91 cent area for you to get, or for me anyway, is not financial advice for me to get short on this this zone here. Also as well, there is the added confluence, or one of the confluences, of a decent area of resistance where that area has been traded. So yeah, I do think that if prices do break above this level, when you look to the left, again, it's been touched once already. So not to say that it can't react off of here and go to the downside, but I think this is going to be a better, fresher area of supply to look for short trades. Dollar CAD, and the dollar's rallied against the Canadian dollar from last week. So I was saying that we could see prices bounce off of here, and obviously you'll see in the analysis, and it actually did come Monday. And or there was a deeper pullback if you want to be a buyer of the dollar, which obviously it didn't do. The prices have come back into the supply zone, and you'd have to really want to be a buyer of the Canadian dollar in order for to get, you know, short on this. For me, it's not really a pair that I'm interested in. If I was looking to, you know, trade this pair, it would be more on a dollar buy based off of potentially higher than expected inflation, and maybe with the Fed expected to hike maybe one more time. Well, they're expected to hold rates, but they may surprise the market by hiking one more time, and that would, you know, send the dollar a lot higher in valuation against the Canadian dollar, who are actually holding rates. Why have I got one more hike expected? Sorry, that's a bit outdated. They're actually holding rates. They're on hold. New Zealand dollar, US dollar, zooming out. Again, we've come up to a supply zone last week where we did sell off. I think the sell-off was more driven by some disappointing news out of China and China's recovery. But overall, this one is pretty bit more difficult to read. The RBNZ are expected to hike one more time, and the Fed are expected to hold rates. So I think any buying opportunities would be decent down at these lows. Of course, you've got the first area of demand here, and even a demand zone here at the moment. But I think for an overall auction or range perspective, I think the cheapest price is going to be down at the 61 cent area, just below that. But of course, you know, anyway, traders are going to try their luck here, which is actually a decent area to look for. Buy trade technically, because you do have that level of support and resistance in that zone. So let's see what happens, but not really a pair I'm interested in trading. I am interested in trading the pound dollar, which is actually putting back quite nicely to some zones that I think prices may reverse, albeit found by the market to be a decent bargain. So we did have some data this week. The UK economy growth was at 0.1%. Wasn't great. I think it was underwhelming, but at least they avoided any kind of negative growth. And this is why the UK sluggish growth rate is too much for the Bank of England. Central bank worried inflation will persist for longer. Strong jobs market and fewer workers fueling wage price spiral. And so Britain's economy is headed for a period sparring growth just above the threshold of a recession. But for now, even a hesitant pace of expansion is ringing alarm bells at the Bank of England. So basically what this article is saying is that when you hike rates too much, you can have, it has an effect on the economy. And so if inflation remains high and they have to keep hiking, then the trade-off with that is that although the pound may appreciate, your or what they are doing is causing a contraction in the economy to come a lot sooner. And so you know, the UK central bank is anxious to return double digit inflation back to the 2% target, and has estimated the economy can grow at a dismal pace. Can only grow at a dismal pace without adding to upward pressure on prices. And so again, it's a delicate balance in acts. You hike rates, which is fine, but you know, you're going to affect economic growth. But if you hike too much, Bank of America expects another UK rate hike after hawkish Bank of England forecast. And so economists at Bank of America are now predicting another rate hike from UK central bank in June after policymakers warned on Thursday of persistent food inflation. So the Bank of England did hike this week, and so they are still hawkish, but they've got one eye on the economy, and so they're going to be again quite concerned. They may probably hike one more time, but they know that if they keep hiking, then contraction in the economy and a potential recession is near, especially because growth really wasn't great in the latest reading. So going back to the pound dollar, for now, I am still bullish on the pound. Of course, we'll have to watch economic data. I think if the economic data supports a rate hike, continue to support a rate hike, then I think these areas here are going to be nice for a buy trade. In fact, probably maybe something right now or down into those 1-3 50 areas. I think that's going to be a decent bargain. Price was due for a pullback, especially when you look at this on a weekly time frame. You know, you just have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks, and then you have a pretty much a week where the close is pretty much right at its open or the start of the week, and then you have another 3 weeks where you have bullish closes for the week. And so we do, when you get moved like this with no decent pullback, a pullback is expected. So I wouldn't be surprised if prices came down to the 1-2-2s. Wouldn't surprise me if prices came down to there, and that really would represent some sort of fair value, I think, from that high to the low. Let's just have a quick look. So fair value is at the moment is at the 1-2-2-4-4-1s. So between this high, if that's expensive for the pound, and this is a bargain for the pound, then I think fair value is going to be one of the areas to definitely start to look to scale in a bit more. But the first options would be at the 1-2-3-50s and then down to the 1-2-3s. Moving on to the euro dollar. And the euro dollar, again, same thing like the pound, where we're, you know, we're heading back now down into interesting areas of demand. This area obviously was quite expensive, and one of the things I was telling the guys in the mentoring group is to keep an eye, is not trying not to get drawn into price when it's at highs, and trying not to buy at highs. There's always going to be pullbacks, and so pullbacks can be scary when you see these large candles going against you. You think, oh, it's time to sell the euro dollar, but if fundamentally nothing has changed, then in fact all this is doing is just coming down to a price where you probably want to be a buyer, and it's more of a bargain than buying at highs, right? And with the ECB expected to hike, and they're one of the most hawkish central banks at the moment, my money is on buying the euro against the dollar at the moment. And so ECB tightening path is still in home stretch. Guindos tells Soleil, the European Central Bank is in the final leg of its historic cycle of interest rate increases, according to Vice President Luis de Guindos. We have now entered the home stretch of our monetary policy tightening path, Guindos told Il Sol 24 or I think that's how you pronounce it, and that's why we are returning to normality, the 25 basis point steps. So that's quite interesting. But we have a hawkish central banker who says, Mr. Nagel says, nothing is off the table for September meeting. So Bundesbank chief speaks to Bloomberg Television in Japan. Officials are stressing that rate hikes aren't over yet. So European Central Bank governing councillor Joachim Nagel refused to exclude that interest rate increases may persist beyond the summer. So he says inflation is still very sticky, where he's attending a group, and he said describes price gains as a very stubborn phenomenon. So either way you look at it, it looks like the ECB are not done hiking yet, whereas you can see the difference with the US, for example, who are just, you know, more likely to be on hold, right? And so there's a divergence there. And so for me, You know, I'm looking to buy the euro around these prices, decent pullback, decent discounts down into fair value. And so let's see what happens on this. Again, this isn't financial advice. Please do your own research, right? And if it makes sense, then you can place your hard-earned capital on a trade, but not too much, of course. Manage your risk. So there's that. If you are looking to get short on this currency pair, though, if you are, there are supply zones. There's quite a large supply zone up the top, right, which is pushing prices down. And you can look for pullbacks into these 109.50s, 110 areas to look for potential short trade. Aussie dollar. In fact, I am more bullish on the Australian dollar. One of the reasons why was because they did a surprise hike, and they are actually quite hawkish. And also as well, if China starts to grow again, even though there was disappointing data, in fact, I think it was inflation data, I do think that the that could reignite the Australian dollar to go long. So for me, this area at the lows and just below it, I think are really nice areas to look for any kind of buy trades. You can see last week, obviously, prices came up to this area on the for the US dollar, and with, again, disappointing news for China. I think that's what's happened. It's just really kind of the Australian dollar has sold off. But I think this is obviously clearly seen, this area here, seen as a bargain price for the Australian dollar as far as an exchange rate. And so I do think that if prices do come down here and even just below, that would be really nice for a buy. I think the Australian dollar would be a bargain down here. But again, that really depends on A, how hawkish the RBA are, and B, China's growth as well. And looking at gold, so gold, I'm waiting for a pullback on gold. Hasn't quite pulled back. I don't really want to be buying at these highs. I do want to be buying in this demand zone, and prices did make new highs. So you can actually technically draw the demand zone there. I'm going to make this supply zone a bit thinner, maybe up top here. So yeah, you can wait for pullbacks, which I think I would want to do, especially down into these 1980s, 1960s, but prices may not get down there. Reason being is because we have gold. Looks best hedge as debt ceiling angst builds, RBC says. So recent gains have put bullion within reach of record high. Potential US rate cuts this year also supporting the metal. So mounting fears over the US debt ceiling crisis will benefit gold as investors brace for potential chaos in financial markets, according to RBC Capital Markets. So hope for a deal to avert the first ever US default was set back after President Joe Biden and House Speaker Kevin McCarthy postponed a meeting on Friday that had been aimed at resolving the impasse. However, the delay signals that staff-level talks were yielding progress, according to people familiar with the matter. RBC market strategist Christopher Looney said that the fraught negotiations had set the stage for a near-term boost to bullion, which is within striking distance of a record high. Even assuming a deal is eventually reached, we would disregard potential growing financial angst as the deadline approaches, he said in a note. In the near term, we believe gold looks like the best hedge. So if you are a doom and gloomer, then obviously you would want to look to buy gold. So I think any pullbacks are going to be decent buying opportunities, because even if the debt ceiling is obviously agreed and extended, there's still more risk events on the horizon: US recession, banking fears, credit crunch fears, etc. So I do think the path of least resistance is to the upside on gold. So any pullbacks, deep pullbacks, are obviously better and cheaper to buy gold for the upside. If this happens, gold. There was an article, I think it was last week or the week before, in last week's video, where I showed that central banks are buying gold. I think China is buying gold at a record pace for like the sixth month in a row. So central banks aren't just buying gold just to kind of sell it, you know, 2 weeks later, right? Or a week later, they buy gold for the medium to long term. So regardless of what price does in the short term, I think gold will still be a buy, and if it pulls back to that 19, especially at 1940 area, I think that's going to be a really nice technical area to look for. A buy. And so that brings us to the end of this week. For those who are interested in the pairs that I am watching, this is normally reserved for the members in the private Discord group, but I thought I'd just show you guys what, you know, pairs I'm really interested in. And the ones that I'm interested in are the dollar yen short, euro dollar long, pound dollar long, euro CAD long, pound CAD long, Aussie CAD long, and Aussie dollar long. I've got several on my watch list where I'm interested for a particular maybe setup. I'm just keep watching based off of risk off and risk on sentiment. But that's really my my trades for the week. And also as well, if you do want to get access to more in-depth analysis, not only fundamentals but technicals, I do have a mentoring group. You can go to trading180.com, and here are, you know, my videos that I produce pretty much every day, if not every other day, for the guys. And the last one was in-depth technical and fundamental analysis, actually, on the pairs that I am looking to trade and trade setups, as well as we have our weekly group call on Zoom. So if you want to, you know, everyone who's in the group asks questions, it's a live group call, and have it every single Wednesday. In fact, I had it on Thursday this week, because for the first time in years, simply because I got caught out by the King's coronation. I thought my days were messed up, but anyways, we still had it. And yeah, the information, in-depth analysis is all there, stuff that you don't will never see on YouTube. Anyways, that's it for this week, guys. Don't forget, after this analysis, you have the euro dollar Q1 fundamental review to watch. So hope you enjoy that as well, and take care, and speak soon. Hi, my name is Leon Rowe, currency trader and trading coach at trading180.com. And in this video, I'm going to review the euro dollar for the first quarter of 2023 and really get a look into how fundamentals affected price. And if you're new to the channel, a warm welcome to you. And if you're obviously returning, an equally warm welcome to you. And if you don't know, I am quite fundamentally driven. I use fundamentals for my directional bias and then look for the technicals as timing. And if you are new to fundamentals or don't necessarily understand fundamentals or are having a hard time in understanding the fundamentals and applying it to your technicals and really want to try to improve your trading, I have this video obviously that you're watching and several other videos, and I will put links to the description, and it should pop up in the top right hand side of the video. So whenever you see something pop up, that would be me just recommending a fundamental analysis video that I think you should watch. So let's get into it. Let's get into the fundamentals and look at the review. So just as a basic understanding and a reminder, I guess, is that there are three main, macroeconomic data points that we should look at when it comes to Forex fundamentals and what really kind of moves price, at least over the medium to long term. And they are gross domestic product and inflation. And those two will have an effect on interest rates and what the central bank does with interest rates. And so looking at GDP first, typically when you have gross domestic product and a growing and expanding and a boom in the booming cycle of the economic cycle, it typically leads to currency appreciation if you have growth. And if you have contraction, then, you know, leading into some sort of recession or bust slump phase of the economic cycle, that typically leads to currency devaluation or depreciation, right? And so looking at inflation, central banks have a 2% target and a mandate. They are mandated to get inflation to the 2% target. Now, 2% inflation is actually an acceptable currency devaluation. It's seen as, you know, again, acceptable, where it's not too hot, not too cold. The Goldilocks kind of economy of inflation, if you get the reference. Whereas if inflation goes above the 2%, then actually that is seen as unacceptable currency devaluation. So inflation rising is actually currency devaluation. And in fact, this should say, and I should have put this one below 2%. Yeah, put that now. Inflation, right? If inflation is below 2% and maybe trending away from the 2% target, so it's going to maybe 1 or 0 and then it goes into the minus. In fact, that is unacceptable currency appreciation. So if inflation goes towards the negative, towards 0, then in fact the currency is appreciating. All right. Now, depending on what is going on with GDP and inflation will determine a central bank's decision on what they would do with interest rates. And there's the interest rate cycle, and pretty much interest rates do go in cycles. And so inflation is above 2%, right? Central banks will typically tend to hike, right? And that leads to currency appreciation, because what they want to do is actually counter, yeah, currency devaluation. So as we said, if inflation is above the 2% and trending away, then that is unacceptable currency devaluation. And to counter that, right, they need to hike rates, so that and hiking rates has the effect of appreciating, you know, creating demand for the currency, which should create a currency appreciation to kind of stem a currency devaluation caused by inflation. Now, if the central bank is on hold, then currencies, the currency, they accept the currency value, yeah. So they think to themselves that, yeah, we like the currency at this value, yeah. And the inflation, if inflation is below the 2%, then in fact they will typically tend to cut interest rates, and cutting interest rates has the effect, or can have the effect, of depreciating a currency. Because if inflation is below 2%, that is unacceptable currency appreciation. And so again, to counter the appreciation of a currency, they have to cut rates to try to depreciate the currency, so that they can stop the currency appreciating too much. And also as well, it's well worth noting that the if central banks hike too much, this will cause economic contraction. I'm not going to get into that in this video, but again, I have a video explaining that, which I will put in the top right hand side of the of this video. So click on that maybe afterwards when you come back, and maybe review this video. And so, buy the rumor, sell the fact. Buying the rumor is what we do as fundamental traders, and having a fundamental approach, because that's where the money is made. You know, it's secondary whether the actual fact comes to pass, right? But the money is made in buying the rumor. That is, you know, we need to get ahead of the curve. And so that is really what the point is with fundamental analysis. It's getting ahead of everybody else, trying to get ahead of these technical traders who have no idea what's going on, and, you know, buying at bargain prices and looking where something is expensive, as well as a bargain or a cheap or a discount, and understanding that when if things are changing in the future, then in fact currently this, you know, whatever price of a, you know, the exchange rate is of a currency pair, in fact that is probably cheap, or it might be expensive, again depending on what happens with, you know, gross domestic product, inflation, and interest rates. So it's all about buying the rumor. The fact, whether it comes true or not, is secondary. And so let's look at central bank policy differentials, because that's what we're ultimately trading in currency land, and euro dollar, obviously the most traded currency in Forex. And so when we're looking at GDP, inflation, and interest rates, we're comparing those, you know, Europe's data with the US data, and seeing where the differentials are. Yeah, so if one central bank, for example, is hawkish, right, very hawkish, hawkish meaning that they are likely to hike interest rates compared to a currency that is not as hawkish or maybe a bit dovish, which means that they may want to either hold or cut rates, then there's a differential there, right? Because we know that hiking interest rates appreciates a currency, cutting rates devalues a currency. So the biggest kind of divergence you can get is when one central bank is hiking rates and another is cutting. But that doesn't necessarily happen all the time and every day. But you know, what we're looking for is differences as to why one central bank is likely to be a bit more aggressive in, you know, their hiking of rates currently, compared to, for example, another, or why one central bank is likely to, for example, continue hiking and leading their hiking in terms of the other central bank, say central bank B, is likely to hold first. It's kind of like a leading and lagging dynamic, but we'll get into that maybe another video. Anyways, let's look at the differences between the euro and the dollar in January, February, and March. And so, what was happening in Europe in January? So, euro, according to Bloomberg and an article in Bloomberg, traders were wagering that the ECB will raise rates by another 140 basis points. Yeah, the euro's gains also reflect a surge of optimism over Europe's economic outlook, given lower gas prices and China's reopening, which is seen as a boon for the trade. So, to give us a bit of context, what was happening was in November, December, it was expected that Europe would go into a recession because of higher gas prices. This is due to the Ukraine and Russia tensions and the war that was going on. And so Europe were expected to go into a recession, but due to a some really warm weather and natural gas prices actually coming down, it helped the economy. And so the economy actually didn't go into a recession. It actually avoided a recession and started to grow a little bit. And although inflation, you know, was high, it helped the central bank by them actually being able to hike rates. Because if they went into a recession, then hiking rates in a recession actually makes things a lot worse. And so, yeah, inflation, although it was rising, Europe had a bit of a dodged a bit of a bullet in terms of avoiding a recession. And so the traders, right, were placing bets that in fact, with rising inflation and a decent economy, that the, you know, Europe were able to hike a lot more, so by 140 basis points. Whereas in the US at the time, this is from the same article, only around 60 basis points of further Fed tightening, right? Tightening meaning hiking, is priced for the rest of 2023. So you can see that the European Central Bank was were being seen as being more hawk, way more hawkish than the Federal Reserve were, right? So markets are now leaning towards a 25 basis point rate rise from the Fed come February, the smallest in nearly a year. And so again, you can see the hawkishness between the two. The European Central Bank was seen as being way more hawkish, and the Fed actually were seen as again less hawkish, slightly dovish. So what happened on the charts in January? Let's look at January. And so this is from the beginning of 2023 at the beginning, and we can look at, you know, until February the 1st, and again what was expected, you know, happened. So in our private mentoring group, Discord group, you know, we've been long, and I've said I've been long since the end of December, you know, right at the beginning of January, somewhere around there. And we had a long bias on the euro dollar, or getting on the long on the euro. And so, you know, this is basically is, you know, what played out. And so many of the traders will attest to this. Many made a decent amount. And so, yeah, for the whole of January, had a long bias, right? Getting in long on that euro dollar. And that's pretty much what played out. So let's go to February euro dollar. So Europe, European Central Bank may need to deliver another half point interest rate increase after a planned hike of that size at next month's meeting, according to the Governor Council member Class Knott. And so I think in February they did hike by 50 basis points, and the consensus was that they probably may need another 50 basis point hike in order to try to combat inflation. But there was a shift, in fact, with the Federal Reserve, right? Whereas, in this month, we had Federal Reserve officials could shed light on how many policymakers saw the case for a larger interest rate increase at their last meeting, whether they anticipated the need to take rates higher than previously thought to tame persistently high inflation. And so remember the previous month, we saw that the market was expecting probably around about 60 basis points for the rest of 2023. What had happened was is that inflation was a bit sticky and so persistently high. And so to get, again, inflation down, you know, the market kind of changed its view or slightly amended its view to think that, or the Federal Reserve did as well, was that the rumor was that they may actually hike more than expected, yeah? And so with that being said, the market had to price that in. So though the euro was still hawkish, in fact, there was a much more hawkish sentiment to the dollar, right? Which then should mean that the dollar would have to be revalued and appreciate a bit more against the dollar, right? Because that there was a change in sentiment. And if we go to February, so February 1st to March the 1st, this is basically what you saw, right? You saw prices start to, you know, make lower highs, lower lows, as the rumor of a 50 basis point hike was coming into play, yeah? And again, it was a rumor because it actually did not happen. So I think they hiked by 25 basis points, but the rumor was that they may hike more than expected. And so that had to be priced in to the market, whereas the month before, they were seen as maybe being a bit dovish, yeah? So that is pretty much what had happened during the charts on February. Now, into March. So euro, money markets traders briefly priced in a 4% ECB terminal rate in the wake of the releases, which would exceed the peak in borrowing costs at the turn of the century. That compared to a 3.5% expected earlier this year, with traders now betting the ECB will keep raising rates through February 2024. And so, in fact, that was very, very hawkish for the euro, and the market was expecting even more rate hikes than they had previously expected, the month before. And so again, just similar to what happened with the US in February, where there was a bit of a change in hawkishness. In fact, money markets had priced in a higher terminal interest rate. And so, you know, from 3.5%, and so that was quite hawkish for the euro. Whereas in Europe, the statement is it says now we are starting to feel those long and variable lags with which monetary policy works. Ballerina Urucci, chief U.S. economist at T. Rowe Price Associates, told Bloomberg Television on Friday the 1st. Sign of that is, I think, what we are seeing with Silicon Valley Bank here. Lots of businesses and banks we are going to find this year aren't able to operate at these higher interest rates. So again, to give this a bit more context, we all know what we should know all about, you know, Silicon Valley Bank collapsing and other banks. I think Silvergate Bank or something like that. And there were, you know, banks in the US that were failing, and this was brought on by higher interest rates. And so, one of the factors was high interest rates. So let's go back to when I pretty much was talking about hiking too much causes economic contraction. So borrowing and lending costs were obviously affecting the banks as it was going higher, as the Federal Reserve were hiking. And that was just one of the effects of hiking interest rates on the economy and on, you know, companies and banks. And so the sentiment really was that how can the Federal Reserve continue to be very hawkish and continue to hike if there may be more banks in problems? And yes, there were European banks, you know, that were in problems. I think it was Deutsche Bank had a bit of a bail-in out as well. But it was seen that the US banks were in a lot more problems than European banks. And so when you have, you know, a bit of a credit crunch and a credit crisis where the US is most affected, it means that if, you know, there's a credit crunch, that would mean a contraction in the economy, and a contraction in the economy may mean obviously a recession sooner rather than later. And again, hiking in that environment is not prudent, because if you keep hiking, you're going to exacerbate potential for a recession, right? You're bringing the recession closer to you. And so the, you know, Europe, while they had, you know, the quite a hawkish bias, which did, you know, later change to be a bit more cautious as well alongside the Federal Reserve, there was still a hawkishness, or they were still and still are more hawkish than the Federal Reserve currently in terms of interest rate hikes. So what happened during March, and this played out again, a more hawkish European Central Bank, there was a bit of a wobble, but ultimately we ended up going higher. And in fact, sorry, I haven't actually cancel this one sec, sorry. All right, so here we are, we used to do year to date. Yeah, so here we are in March. Yep, so from here to here. In March, we had prices really kind of move around 400 pips from the low. Nice buying opportunities at these lows before prices went to the upside in March. And so, you know, we're seeing the divergence between both central banks again play out into April and into May, as nothing's really changed per se. The European Central Bank are still more hawkish than the Federal Reserve and are expected to hike more than the Federal Reserve, and you're seeing obviously prices drift higher. And so with that, doing a bit of a fundamental review, it's looking at the actual data, looking at GDP, we can see that the US are the blue columns, and you've got the European growth rate as represented by the dots. And so we can see that from January into April, we've seen a slight, you know, decline in terms of GDP growth rate for the US. But in fact, in Europe, we've had a bit of growth, right? Prices have gone to the upside. Yeah, the number is lower in terms of growth rate, but remember that the European Central Bank was supposed to go into a recession, and the fact that they avoided recession, two negative quarters of growth, right? They avoided that, and so that was seen as an absolute positive for Europe, yeah? So we've had a bit of a divergence there, where we had one central, one economy, you know, contracting, and one actually, you know, growing, although be it, you know, quite slightly. And then we've got inflation rate. And so the US inflation rate again has come down to around 5% on here on this axis. On the right-hand side, we've got the European inflation, which is actually around 7%. And you can see it slightly ticked up as well, the latest inflation data. So with that being said, let me go back. So inflation obviously for the US is coming down, whereas although it's come down recently for the European Central Bank, it's a lot higher than the US, and B, it's on the upturn slightly. So it looks like the European Central Bank are likely to be a lot more hawkish than the US. And we can see what's happened with interest rates since the beginning of the year, and you can see in February The European Central Bank hiked by 50 basis points, whereas the Federal Reserve actually hiked by 25 basis points, and then you had another 50 basis point hike by the European Central Bank, and then you had only a 25 basis point hike from March into April, right? And so whereas the European Central Bank has hiked by 1% or 100 basis points, the Federal Reserve only hiked by 50 basis points or 0.5%. So again, very hawkish from the European Central Bank. And so again, seeing that on price, it's no wonder you're seeing, you know, prices grind, you know, a lot, you know, higher. And towards the end of the year, what's expected is that the euro dollar should reach at least 115. So let's see if that actually comes to play and comes out, comes to fruition, right? Anyways, just some notes, it's things you must be aware of. So data must support the narrative. You must, you know, have the data support your trade idea. Now, we're dealing with trade probabilities, right? There are no certainties and no one has a crystal ball. And so when you've developed a trade idea and you've got a trade idea, you can continue to kind of hold the trade or have that, you know, bias if, for example, let's say the European Central Bank hiking rates, they want to hike rates. And let's say the data supporting that narrative would be a continued, you know, rising inflation, and supporting that may be a decent economy, right? Economy still growing. That data will support the European Central Bank hiking, right? Now, if Europe are going to go into a deep recession, then it's going to be difficult for the European Central Bank to hike in that environment. And so, you know, it's you can't start to say, all right, then, well, I'm just going to start, you know, buying the European Central Bank if the data doesn't support the narrative. If inflation starts coming down, then although, yes, in this day, currently today, you know, the European Central Bank are more hawkish than the Federal Reserve, that can change if inflation starts to drop like a stone. Then the European Central Bank are going to say, well, what's the point in hiking if inflation is coming down naturally and normally? There's no need to hike. And so data must support the trade idea narrative. Yeah, and there are, again, no probabilities, no certainties in trading. We deal with the probabilities and there are no certainties in trading. And think bigger picture. So there's lots of data points that can get you confused and distracted. The best thing is to think about the bigger picture. Observe the higher time frames and look at the daily and weekly time frames. Try not to get drawn into every single lower time frame, every 5 minute, you know, support or supply zone or trade setup, because you can have situations where you might get a pullback. Right now, in March, you had a nice move from this high to this low to this high. Right now, There was a pullback of around 200 pips. Yeah, this pullback on the daily was around 200 pips, something like that. From that high to that low, 217 pips. And so if you were to zoom in on this onto, like, you know, some sort of 15 or 5 minute chart, a lot of traders will try to, you know, will say, oh, well, you know what, Leon said that, you know, I should be bullish. I've done my fundamental analysis and I want to be bullish on this, you know, this currency pair. Now, yes, you're making the right choice in terms of being, you know, your directional bias, but ultimately you still have to understand that there's value, right? You're buying at highs. Don't buy at highs. If this is a move that has gone, you know, several hundred pips from this low to this high, in fact, what you should be doing is looking for discounts. Yeah, discounts. And one of the discounts I look for is fair value. And so if I go back to the daily time frame chart, between this high and this low, yeah, 50% of that would represent fair value. So what happened was is that you can see here that price came down to fair value. Right, and that was really the area that you'd probably now want to start to look for a trade setup. If you're looking for every 5 minute, 10 minute trade setup, you could be right about your direction, but because you're buying at highs and the institutions want to buy for discounts, pullbacks, you know, 200 pips might seem like a trend on a 5 minute time frame, but it's really just a pullback. And if you understand the fundamental bias, just really kind of zoom out and look at where you are in context of, you know, where expensive is, where cheap is, and don't FOMO in at highs, right? Don't FOMO in these areas. Wait for the pullback, wait for a decent price pullback, fair value, and then look for potential long trades, right? And that's not necessarily me telling you, you know, a strategy or anything like that, but just giving you the context of why you should kind of zoom out and look at the higher time frame, the bigger time frames, and give yourself a bit of context. Then once prices pull back into a nice, you know, zone and maybe support, resistance, or supplies, you know, a demand zone that you want to look to get involved in, then maybe go down into the lower time frame, start to look for some entries or whatever your setup may be. So look at daily, weekly time frames for context. Directional bias really doesn't change too often. And so, you know, I've been long on the euro pretty much now since the beginning of the year, as I mentioned before. And so that's what I'm releasing this in. I'm recording this actually in May. So it's been 5 months since I've been long on the euro, and it hasn't really changed at all. Actually, it hasn't changed at all. And so directional bias, once you get a good trade idea, it doesn't necessarily change from week to week. Some traders will say, oh, well, what am I going to be going long this week or short this week? If you have a good trade idea, you know, you can be in a trade for months. And again, I've created a video, I think it was like maybe a couple years ago, a few years ago, where I was detailing how I was short on the euro dollar for a whole year. In fact, I was short for over a year, but I just made a video similar to this where I detail month to month, you know, my euro dollar short trades, and my bias and the reasons why. And again, I'll put that in the link in the top right hand side. And so directional bias hasn't changed too often. It's not a week to week thing. You can have a directional bias for a good few months, if not longer, once the data does support that narrative. And yeah, that's pretty much it. So if you're still around watching this video, thank you for watching to the end. And also as well, for the next video, I thought I'd put it out there. If you've got a, you know, for the second quarter video, I'll do these every quarter. So if you want me to analyze a pair, just suggest it in the chat below if you're watching this on YouTube. And the pair with the most, you know, likes, or the most suggested pair, I'll do a similar analysis to this video, or the same analysis to this video, on that currency pair. So it could be pound dollar, it could be pound yen, it could be Aussie CAD, you know, just whatever you want. But again, the most popular pair, the most suggested pair, I will do a second quarter analysis on that for you guys. And yeah, finally, there is mentoring available. You know, we can get access to the private Discord community where you can take your fundamental analysis really to the next level and go to trading180.com. I don't really have the mentoring open 24/7. I do have periods where I have mentoring, as I like to keep the group small and really kind of focus on smaller groups. And so whenever the next opening is, it will be on the website for you to join then. So guys, take care. I hope you enjoyed the video. Suggest a pair that you want me to look back on and give you the analysis on. And again, the most recommended pair is what I would do. Anyways, guys, take care. All the best. Speak to you soon.